supervisor is back there tonight. I'm currently studying music therapy at the Hayes School of Music.
And my name is Nick Allian. I am the third cellist here, and I'm studying music education. Our next piece for the night is Blue Cathedral by Jennifer Higdon. Higdon was born in 1962 and grew up just over the hill in Tennessee. She's won a Pulitzer Prize as well as a Grammy for her compositions. Blue Cathedral was commissioned in 1999 by the Curtis Institute of Music, where Higdon obtained her doctorate and still teaches today.
As noted in Nick's introduction, Higdon is a living composer writing modern classical music. So the upcoming piece pulls from impressionistic traditions, but she uses modern techniques to create her own voice. Blue Cathedral is a prime example of Higdon's extensive use of percussion. They have a lot of extended techniques and syncopated rhythms, and I know we have all enjoyed watching the percussion section put this together. Higdon requires so much percussion that we have some honorary percussionists in the ensemble, and they're playing some unusual instruments. So first, I wanted to show you all the Chinese health reflex balls. Everyone can play those. And play them up high. And Higdon had a box of them in her home, and she bumped into them and was inspired to use them in the piece. She liked the sound. Then we have some glasses on stage as well. These were lent to us this afternoon by Chancellor Everts. Our first set of glasses were facing some personal challenges with being tuned. So we are very grateful for her contribution this afternoon. Some other modern elements that Higdon uses include open fourth and fifth intervals, as well as chromaticism, so be sure to listen out for that.
Blue Cathedral was originally intended to honor the 75th anniversary of the Curtis Institute of Music. However, it took on a more personal meaning for Higdon. It was written in memory of her late brother, Andrew Blue, who died quite suddenly in 1998. Higdon was overwhelmed during and after this, working on more than six compositions at the same time. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, I am so sorry about that. During that time, she was very overwhelmed. In fact, this deeply affected her work. And in her own words, "I began writing this piece at a unique juncture in my life and found myself pondering the question of what makes a life."
And Higdon goes on to say that Blue Cathedral is reflective of a journey through life, our inner travels, and the places that our souls carry us. She also suggests the imagery of standing in a glass cathedral as it rises into the sky. So with this in mind, the beginning of the piece is reflective of a calm and contemplative mood before moving to a section of increased dissonance as the journey begins. Here's a short example of this.
This section has a wandering color to it. The high-pitched violins contrast with the pure notes of brass to create a search for meaning. This continues on into anger, strife, and discord. There isn't a particular section where we can hear Andrew's death, but it can definitely be said that this section represents Higdon's frustration and distraught at his death. This is underscored by the dissonant chords and rhythmic agitation. From this point on, on, there's a decided tone shift. The piece seems to be flying forwards. The strings are running around underneath, and the brass is flying out the top. But we'll wait on showing you this one. We don't want to spoil everything.
And a final piece of background information is that Higdon was a flutist, and her brother played the clarinet. So you'll hear a lot of flute and clarinet solos throughout the piece. The beginning features a flute solo. It actually comes in as the first solo voice. And this is because Higdon was the oldest sibling. And at the end of the piece, the flute and clarinet solo lines are playing off of one another before the flute line closes and the clarinet line continues on into an increasingly higher register. And here's an example of the two solos. As I mentioned, both the beginning and end are very soloistic, making the piece rather cyclical, as life is, and that is what Higdon intended.
Thank you for coming this afternoon, and we hope you enjoy Blue Cathedral. Thank you.
my name is Emily Wills, and I am a music therapy student here at ASU, and I play violin in the orchestra.
And I'm Andrew Henry, and I play timpani in the orchestra. The last piece on our program this afternoon is Edvard Grieg's Peer Gynt Suite No. 1. This suite comes from Grieg's incidental music to the play Peer Gynt by Henrik Ibsen. Henrik Ibsen was the leading literary figure in Norwegian literature in the late part of the 19th century. He was a very influential writer, and coincidentally, the first composer on our program, Gustav Mahler, was an avid reader of Ibsen's work. The play that this suite comes from was written as a five-act dramatic poem that was not intended to be staged. However, when Ibsen later decided to attempt to stage the work, he contacted Edvard Grieg, his friend, to write the music.
Edvard Grieg was the leading Norwegian composer at the time and was also very, very excited to work on the music for this play. But the play was not a musical. The actors didn't sing and there's no lyrics to any of the music. But I think of the music more as a movie soundtrack that we would hear today. So the actors would perform and the music would be an element to set the scene, as it were. So the first movement Andrew is going to talk about, oh, one more thing. Grieg wrote 26 movements altogether for this play, but we're only going to be playing four because that would double the length of our concert tonight, so we're not gonna make you sit through that.
So the first movement is very popular. It's been used in all sorts of movies, commercials, Looney Tunes. So I'll have Devin play the principal flute, play the main theme, which many of you will probably recognize. So for those of you who know that, that movement, or for those of you who recognize it, it comes from a very beautiful piece of music that many would associate with some kind of beautiful scene from the play, but actually, it comes from a scene where he's been abandoned in the desert. So it's quite ironic that this beautiful movement accompanies this kind of not that great of a scene for the main character.
Do we have anyone from Norway in the audience? Any Norwegians? That's surprising. I wonder where that crowd is tonight. Well, anyways. This next place, we're just going to use the Google translation. It is Osa's Death. That is the next movement. And Osa is Peer Gynt's mother. And Peer Gynt is away from home at this point in the play, and an evil sorceress comes to him and haunts him with visions, and he starts realizing how much he neglected his mother. So he returns home and unfortunately finds her on her deathbed. But luckily they get to share one brief moment together before she passes. So this is the theme from this movement. Such a melancholy tune. Well, this next one is actually out of order. So in the program notes, I think it says this, but the pieces are out of order with which they would appear in the play. So this next one is Anitra's Dance, and this actually comes after Morning Mood, the piece that Andrew spoke about. So after Peer Gynt finds himself abandoned in the desert with no friends, he does find himself with a local tribe who thinks he is a prophet, so that is lucky. But Peer Gynt is not your average protagonist. He is not all bad, but he's not really all good either. And actually, he goes through a lot of adventures throughout the play, but he doesn't really wind up much better than when he started, really. But he finds himself with his tribe and makes the mistake of trying to seduce the chief's daughter, Anitra. And she plays along for a little bit, but then she ends up getting the best of him because she ends up running away with all of his possessions and gold and everything he has. So this is the flirtatious dance of Anitra. That theme reminds me of another really flirtatious dance in Carmen, actually the Habanera that Bizet wrote.
The final movement from this work comes from an extended dream sequence in the second act where Peer Gynt has an encounter with a large group of trolls. They decide that he will have to marry and become a troll or they will kill him. So those are not the best options, and he attempts to run away. So this movement starts out soft, reflecting him trying to sneak away. And as the trolls catch up to him and chase him, the music gets louder and faster. So here is the opening of this movement, where it's still very quiet and a little slower. So that will be the final movement from this work. Our last work on the concert. So thank you very much for coming this afternoon.